So we filed Resolution 718, it was unanimously approved. Nakalagay po doon mga limang hakbang paano natin mapapaabot no sa buong mundo itong problema natin. And it was enumerated there. One of them was to take it to the UN General Assembly, one was to take it to other avenues like APEC, ASEAN, other international fora. Of course, the first one was to continue bilateral discussions with China, to continue to dialogue. Hindi po namin tinanggal yun. Kasi sabi ko nga, kung gusto po nila maging mabait na kapitbahay, di tuloy natin pag-uusap, tuloy natin pag-uusap. And then 1 week after, bam! They start water cannoning our troops and our supply missions to our Marines in Ayung and Shoals. And so, sabi ko nga, Karen, di ba, gusto po natin mag... Sabi ko, and I'll say this verbatim, gusto namin magpakaibigan, pero bakit China ang hirap mong mahalin? Sabi ko, napakahirap. So, and that's why, Karen, there's other things that we can do. So we enumerated there five, which is more on the diplomatic side. The other is one that I was very passionate about over the weekend, which is basically to blacklist Chinese infrastructure firms. Mm-hmm. And we need to do, you know, parang ginigisa natin sa sarili nating mantika, di ba? Here we are helping and standing together with our troops in the West Philippine Sea, protecting our sovereignty. Ha? Ito ay ating teritoryo ito na talagang pinaglaban ni Rizal, ni Bonifacio, ni Aguinaldo, itong teritoryo ng Pilipinas. Tapos sa isang iglip nawawala sa atin. So I said, why don't we ban state-owned corporations na from government projects, kasi meron pa rin mga government projects, DOTR, DPWH, na gumagamit ng kontrata o kumukuha ng kontrata galing sa mga Chinese state-owned firms. Why? Kasi syempre, yung nagbabayad nung tayong dalawa, Karen, yung buwis natin, yung kinakaltas sa akin sweldo, kinakaltas din sa sweldo mo, Karen, binabayad natin doon sa mga project na yan. Ito mga project, nagbabayad sa state-owned corporation sa China mismo at gagamitin nila yon para sa kanilang military, babalik ulit dito sa atin. No? So, ginigisa na natin ang sarili natin sa ating sariling mantika. No? That, ika nga, that's the saying. And so, we want to stop that. And the beauty is, I've already discussed this with the DOTR Secretary, Secretary Bautista. I've invited him over to the office the other day in the Senate. Ang sabi po niya, luckily, nag-back out, hindi rin natuloy yung China doon sa South Rail papunta ng Bicol na mga linya ng ating trend. So sabi ko, kung ganun, let's give it to like-minded nations at mga kaibigan natin, katulad ng Japan, South Korea, even Vietnam, matalik na kaibigan natin ang Vietnam. And let's move it up to other infrastructure projects like the DPWH. Kasi ang alam ko, meron mga tulay, kung ano-anong pondo para sa mga iba't ibang infrastructure projects of the DPWH. So, we want to take it a step further. It makes no sense. Yung sinabi kong boycott of Chinese goods, actually, the context of that is an example that I gave was Vietnam. So, when I said, we can do what Vietnam did. Alam mo, Karen, dati number one trading partner ng Vietnam ang China. Nung nakita nila na dehado sila dito sa West Philippine Sea, nakipagbakbakan din sila doon sa West Philippine Sea against China, they pivoted. They got a free trade agreement in the European Union for their goods. Meron sila. They're only one of two countries, I think Singapore and Vietnam. Now, they also decided to engage with the United States na dati nilang kalaban. But they're engaged with the United States, and you know what? They are now a top economy in the ASEAN, growing faster than us. And I'm sure you've been to Vietnam, Karen. You've seen the development there. Their focus is not with China. Their focus is with other countries. They're getting the outflow of companies that are leaving China. A bulk of it is going to Vietnam. So my suggestion to the national government, and we're supporting the president on this, is to start pivoting back. Let's get a free trade agreement to the United States para lahat ng produkto natin. And po, alam mo, sa lahat ng senador at congressman ng United States, payag sila na kasi ano tayo yan, we're their number one ally in the region. So we pivot back there. We were with the president of the EU, the European Commission recently, van der Ley, and she was President van der Ley, and she's very, very receptive to having a free trade agreement as well with the Philippines. Para sa ganun, yung produkto natin, yung mga bananas at pineapples namin sa bukid noon, yung iba't ibang produkto sa iba't ibang bansa, ay doon na natin dadalhin. Hindi na po sa China. So, yan po ang plano natin. To, yan ang mga hakbang na makatulong na wala namang, hindi naman military in nature, that we can also help help the pushback, no, of these forces within the West Philippine Sea.
Okay, you've cited many good points there. So I wanted to ask you first with the first one. On blacklisting China state-owned companies for our big ticket infrastructure projects, is the president on board with this? Because you called on the DPWH also recently not to award, for example, the 32-kilometer Bataan-Cavite interlink bridge. Right? That's another one. DPWH yon. For these agencies to actually follow your recommendations, it would have to be implicit coming from the executive to say, okay, all these government projects, give it to Japan, South Korea, etc.
Well, you know, it was an off-the-cuff. When I mentioned this, it was an off-the-cuff statement with an interview of Noli De Castro, Kabayan Noli De Castro. So I haven't, that was last, ano lang po yun, Karen, that was last Friday?
Week.
Or last week, yeah. Thursday or Friday.
Yeah.
So hindi ko pa nakikita si Pangulo. Of course, if I see him, mag-face-to-face po kami na meeting, babanggitin ko sana sa kanya yun, magkaisa po kami ang legislatura and of course, executivo, na tigil na natin yun. The funds, you know, Congress is, the power of the purse is with Congress and the budget actually emanates also from Congress. So we have a bit of persuasive power. It's not that much, Karen, siyempre, iba yung presidente. Pero pagdating sa budget hearing, dadaan din yung budgets ng DPWH sa amin at iba yung mga hensya, ilalatag ko sa kanila. No? I'll put it out on the open and basically say, this is what's happening in the West Philippine Sea. Our troops need our support. Definitely, I'm so happy that the DOTR has already spoken because remember that the Coast Guard is under the DOTR. It makes no sense that your people are being bombarded by water cannons and still you give billion peso contracts to state-owned companies. So my point there, Karen, is yes, we have a bit of persuasive power, hopefully, no, within the budget discussions in the next few months. But at the same time, I'm going to appeal to the president to do that. It doesn't hurt. It won't hurt because I personally feel, let's give it to like-minded.
But that's a matter of political will. That's really a political decision that President Marcos Jr., if he decides to follow your recommendation, he has to be convicted by it because he'll have to stand by it in the next 5 years.
One thing I've known the president for many years is he's a man of his conviction. Isang salita lang po ang ating Pangulo. Kaya natuwa po ako when he gave that statement, no, na if there was any agreement in the past, I rescind it. That was a very important political statement. That's a very statesman-like statement. And you know, as he mentioned and he promised, let's not give up a square inch of our territory, not even a quarter inch of our territory. And I want him to know, and usually he watches your program, Karen, we want him to know that the Senate is squarely behind him on this, that we are squarely behind him on this. This is a defining moment for the Senate and for the Philippine government and also for the people. But let's rally behind our Coast Guard and let's rally behind our Navy on this issue. Territorial. Let me give you a little bit of.
All right.
Opo.
Just make
Opo,
it
Karen, really quickly.
Topic, sir. Go ahead.
Opo.
Yeah.
Tingnan mo, pag-asa island, atin yan. Karen, ha? I have a lot of visuals. Ito yung Ayungin Shoals.
Uh-oh.
Mas malapit pa sa Palawan.
Uh-oh.
Yung Sabina Shoals, mas malapit pa na. Pag sila yung lumapit dito, mawawala na sa atin. Baka Palawan na, magpagising natin na sa Palawan na po sila. We can't allow that to happen, Karen. Not on the graves of our dead heroes, we can't allow that to happen.
Okay, so are we ready to put our money where our mouth is? Let's talk about the budget. I spoke with the Philippine Coast Guard and I was appalled that their intelligence fund is only at 10 million pesos. You have civilian agencies right now, for example, civilian agencies like the Office of the Vice President already requesting for 500 million pesos, the DepEd at 150 million pesos. The whole confidential and intelligence fund is now at 10 billion. And yet you have the Coast Guard at 10 million pesos, Senate President.
Karen, next budget, matutuwa na sila. You have a commitment. And I just can't tell you what the funds are going to go to because it's, of course, more confidential. We don't want to telegraph our punches. But next Congress will increase the budgets of the Coast Guard, the Navy, the Army, especially because of this incident, at least on the Senate side. I've spoken to Speaker Martin, and he also agrees that we should support our troops to a better budget. So, yan ang mangyayari dyan, Karen. I guarantee you, lalaki po intelligence funds nila. At the same time, not only that, getting them equipment. That's why malaga pong binanggit ni Presidente po sa SONA, yung amendments to the... When government purchase things, Procurement Act, the amendments to the Procurement Act, because nakabindin po tayo palagi sa brand new, and brand new is difficult to buy, but there are several countries who are selling slightly. You know, when you say ships, a 10-year-old ship is slightly used. We've been using World War II ships for the last 30 years. So we want to amend the Procurement Act to be able to get them modern, functional, and efficient equipment as soon as possible for all the branches of the armed services.
Is the amendment of the Procurement Act part of your 20 bills before the end of the year? Kabilang po ito, sir.
Opo, ma'am. The sooner the better, particularly for our armed forces. Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Now, moving on next, now, when it comes to a suggestion by, I believe, Jay Batumbakal in the report earlier, is to have a local shipping industry that actually produces for the Coast Guard, for our own needs in patrolling the West Philippine Sea. What is needed, Senate President, for something like that?
We are going to pass, we're committed in the Senate to pass the PDIDA, the Philippine Defense Industry Development Act. Napakahalaga niyan, Karen. Kasi walang tatayo po ng planta dito para sa mga baril, para sa mga barko, aeroplano, kung wala pong kontrata sa gobyerno. So because of the Procurement Act, it's very difficult. You know, they make it difficult. First of all, brand new, certain specifications, only foreign companies can do, which is like 5 years into the business or 10 years into the defense industry business. That's difficult. So what we want to do is pass the law that will allow local players to build these armaments, to build these ships, and give the contracts their preferential treatment, apples to apples. If the they pass the standards, international standards, they'll be given the preferential treatment, the ones that are building it in the Philippines. So yes, we want to do that. As a matter of fact, the Navy, I have to salute them because they ordered from Israel, I forget the name of the Shaldag, I think, the frigate. It's actually patrol boats, small patrol boats. They initially brought in about four. They ordered about, I believe, nine. The five will be assembled in Cavite. Mm-hmm. So they'll hire Caviteños, they'll hire shipbuilders in Cavite. Cavite is also one of the top shipbuilding areas. So we want to do the same for other patrol boats, bigger ships. We can do it in Cebu, can do it in Cavite, but what they need is to pass the PDIDA, which is the Defense Industry Modernization Manufacturing Facilities here in the Philippines, and we can give them the contracts. This will prosper all over the country in what you call eco zones. It will be in defense eco zones. So yan ang kagandahan dyan, Karen. We're gonna pass that. Yan, makakatulong po yan. Remember in Marawi, Karen, nawalan tayo ng bala, nawalan tayo ng baril, naubusan tayo ng bala at baril. We had to beg China at the time, we had to beg Russia and all that. Now, it won't happen again because we will have these industries built here, made by Filipinos for Filipinos.
Okay, now moving on to the Manila Bay reclamation, the president suspended 22 reclamation projects, I believe, except for one. And some have said he only reacted after the United States expressed concern on the environmental effects of reclamation. Plus, there's a blacklisted China state-owned company that's part of the project. So, ang tanong dito, Senate President, ano ba talaga ang issue? Is it an environmental issue for this administration? And perhaps I want to ask you yourself where you stand on this. Or is it because there was one project wherein a China state-owned company was involved?
I think it's not just that. Hindi lang po sa China state-owned project. Ang aking pananaw, talagang napangitan si Pangulo na nawala yung Ross Boulevard. I think, with due respect to whoever personality will be hit here, no? I think the project in front of Ross Boulevard is wrong. I am not against
reclamation.
And yes, because the Senate is on top of reclaimed area. The Senate now, the GSIS. Mm-hmm. What I'm against is, for example, Ross Boulevard, that whole stretch. Alam mo, on many points. Number one, Karen, for decades, that place has been known for this beautiful sunset. Diba? How many people have actually proposed in Ross Boulevard? How many people have had their first kiss on Ross Boulevard? How many people have seen the most beautiful sunsets that are known all over the world in Ross Boulevard? Now you will not see the sunset because all you'll see is buildings and maybe a moat in between Ross Boulevard and that area. Mali yun. The previous administration who gave up that portion was wrong. That Ross Boulevard should be an open boulevard all the way out. Yung tama po sinabi ni Secretary Yulo.
Pero paano yung Senate President? Tuloy yun, no? Because yung harap ng Thomas Boulevard, I believe that's a conglomerate, that's a group of local companies.
Yeah, well, it's all suspended as of the moment. Pero tama sinabi kasi ni Secretary Loizaga, Yulo Loizaga, na kung bumaha sa Ross Boulevard, number one, saan lalabas ang tubig? Di ba palaging babaha dyan? Number one. Number two, pagdating ng disasters, when disasters come, Ross Boulevard becomes the avenue of ships. It can be the relief, where the relief operations area could be. And we can, especially when she was talking about the big one, the big earthquake, we can evacuate people from Ross Boulevard into ships, into safer ground. Di ba po? So on many aspects, on safety, on climate change adaptation, on relief efforts, on just even tourism, as I mentioned in the beginning, that should be a protected heritage site. I mean, that Ross Boulevard should be a protected heritage site. Ang laki-laki pa ng ginastos ng previous administration para magkaroon ng Dolomite Beach. Mm-hmm. Wala na yung Dolomite Beach, eh, harap mo, parang nasa moat ka lang. Sabi ko nga, actually, I messaged the president. I said, Mr. President, the whole Manila Bay starting to look like the Sahara Desert. The Sahara Desert or the sand dunes of Pauai. Mm-hmm. He said it's time to look at
because there's nothing.
And he agreed with me. Okay. He agreed with me. So that's why he came out with the statement. I think we should restudy some of the areas that are being reclaimed. Let's look into that. But again, I'd like to state, hindi naman ako against reclamation per se. But the positioning of the reclamation areas are very, very important. Okay. I think that should have been studied. Parang wholesale ang benta ng reclamation permits nung araw. So hindi ko, I mean, somebody's got to look into that. And I hope that it's being reviewed properly by the DNR. Mm-hmm. Look at Sofitel. My goodness, Sofitel, they used to brag about their beautiful sunsets and sunset-facing rooms. Well, visit it now. And you know what? Ang nakakatakot, yung reclaimed area pa, Karen, behind Sofitel, is 5 feet taller than its seawall. Mm. So, if you have a flood in Sofitel, where is the water going to go? Yeah. It's not going to go out of the bay anymore. It's going to retain a big fish pond inside the Sofitel. So, these are questions that have to be answered.
On the Manila reclamation, before we head on to the budget, is one, who is accountable for this? Is it the Philippine Reclamation Authority alone? Because the 22 projects got the go signal from them. And number two, my other question is, how does this affect how we're viewed business-wise? You know what they say globally when it comes to the Philippines? You already yes. have a project going on, you've spent for the project you're spending, and you can't trust the Philippines to continue or honor its contracts. We've had that, remember, with the airport, right, Senate President?
Yes, yes.
So two
yes.
questions yon. Ang accountability ng Philippine Reclamation Authority, and how does this affect us globally with foreign investors?
Well, not only with the PRA, I think, Karen, there should be other agencies that go through the process. One of them is the DNR, because to be able to get the ECC is very difficult. As you know, you have to have an impact environmental impact study, and how it will affect, of course, flooding, how it affect the flow of water, how it will affect the marine environment, fisher folk. So that process has to be reviewed. It has to be reviewed. And definitely, on the issue of contracts, I think nangingibabaw yung pangangailangan ng taong bayan, di ba? At in this particular case, it's not a mere contract to for an airport, say construction of an airport or running of a port, and then you rescind it and all that. That's a different story. That should not be allowed. But this has an environmental impact, Karen. So, okay, we say, oh, okay, we have a contract, you went through the process, fine, just do it. 2 years from now, baha na yung buong Manila. Parang naging ano na tayo, water world, ika nga, water world. And I think the president will not allow it. I think this administration will not allow it. That's why a very important impact study, environment impact study is being done right now, getting even foreign companies to weigh in. I mean, foreign consultants
experts,
to weigh in,
yeah,
and
yeah.
experts. Mm-hmm. I think that's the very gist of what the president wants to happen. Mm-hmm. And I think there are provisions also in the ECC of these companies that if hindi maganda, hindi maayos no ang pagkagawa nila, pwedeng ma-resign, pwedeng mawala ang ECC. And ECC does not give you the right to trample on the environment, Karen. No? When you're given an environmental compliance certificate, hindi ibig sabihin yan, basagin na natin yung buong environmental setup ng lugar. If that happens, then the ECC can be withdrawn and the project will stop, because it has a what you call this, Karen, it has a commitment to protect and uphold the environment for a country. So that's why it's very important to see all this after the impact study and how it will affect, for example, yung pagbaba. Yung paglabas ng tubig sa Metro Manila, Karen. Binanggit ko nga kanina yung sa Sofitel. 5 feet okay. above the seawall of Sofitel, saan pupunta right. yung tubig kung bumaha sa Sofitel? Hindi na makakalabas po yan,
okay.
Karen.
So let's move on now to that. I mean, I wanted to talk about reclamation more, but I have to move on now to the national budget. So the president has approved the 2024 national expenditure program. Just for our viewers, it's now at 5.768 trillion pesos, no? And the president himself at one point said he was worried with the debt to GDP ratio that we have. I believe, are we at 63% as an president, or 65,
right.
something
yeah.
of that.
That figure, I'm not sure of the figure, but it's in that range.
Okay, so why are we, what are your thoughts on moving on to a much higher budget when, number one, the whole budget by agencies aren't spent, frankly, right? You've called them out on not spending the budget given to them. Humingi ng budget, di naman magastos. And what yes. happens is we do have to borrow, I believe, 40%+ of whatever yes. is in the budget. So where do you see this leading to, Senate President?
Well, Karen, those questions are best asked by our dear friend Sunny Angara, because you should yeah. get him on your program, particularly yeah. on the budget. But I get where you're going, and basically, mag-uutang ba pa tayo ulit? Kasi sobra-sobra yung gastos natin, mas maliit po ang kita. No, it looks like the the BIR, together with the Bureau of Customs, are a bit of they're in a bit of a shortfall from their collection. So yes, I think I believe we'll be short about 1 trillion pesos, no, 1.5 trillion pesos. That's what I've heard from the discussions with Senator Sonny Anguera. When it comes to utilization of budgets, the DBM, that's the DBM's job, to call out secretaries, departments, na kung for the non-utilization, kung hindi po nila nagagamit ng maayos ang kanilang budgets. Kaya nababawasan po sila. Nababawasan, in fairness, nababawasan. But at the same time, meron talagang ahensya na hindi po natin kayang bawasan. For example, DepEd. Diba? Lumala talagang budget ng DepEd. Kailangan natin tulungan sila because they need classrooms. They need to repair classrooms that were destroyed by the floods in these last two big typhoons. We need to construct more classrooms because it's a bigger, every year we have about 1 to 1.5 million new entrants to our basic education system. Then you also have, of course, we have to help the Army, the Navy, the Coast Guard. We want to get them better ships, better boats. So not to mention their MUPs, retirement pay. Lumalaki, lumulobo din po yan. It's unsustainable if we don't do something about it. So talagang tumatas ng tumatas yan. So it's a multitude of problems for a growing population and a growing economy. It's very normal to be, we're trying to pass for a middle-income economy in the next 5 years. So talagang ganyan, kailangan natin gumastos. Lalo na sa DPWs, ang daming build more projects, no? Build better more. So definitely every year, the budget will be going up and increasing. We have to push our collection agencies to be more efficient. To be more efficient in collecting. Diba? Tigil na yung mga plug the loopholes, plug the leakages. When I say plug the leakages, corruption, etc. And hopefully they'll be able to meet the targets that are set out by the Department of Finance.
Okay. Now, it seems that there's a big issue. I mean, in the sense that the confidential and intelligence funds have been increasing through the years. We've seen them. Right. So this particular year, the DBM says 4.5 billion pesos is allocated for the president's office alone. Now you have the vice president asking for 500 for her office, the DepEd for 150 of intelligence. It seems that it's become a very political decision. It's a political accommodation. I know being Senate president, you are with a majority, but when do we put a stop to the increases with these confidential funds? It's very difficult to audit them. Where do you stand on that, sir?
Well, they still go through the process, Karen. Let's put this on record. They go through the process with the COA. They have to submit documentation. They have to submit also their budgets and how it was spent to COA. It's just confidential. You know, you can't bring it out to the public, but COA can flag them. And what we did last year, we set up a special committee on the oversight budget. So, naalala mo yun, Karen, nung pinasa po natin yan last year. Controversial nga po yung mga iba't ibang budgets, like for example, the DepEd and such. But we decided to come up with a special committee. Senator Coco Pimentel is one of the members of the committee. We're going to open the committee again now during the budget deliberation. At doon, under executive session, pag-usapan kung saan talaga ginamit yung pera. Now, tuloy-tuloy pa po yung budget.
I mean, now you have civilian agencies.
Well, the president, yes.
The president?
The president, definitely, yes. Because, for example, nabawasan yung budget ng NICA. Hmm. They didn't have an operational budget. It's the president that stepped in and gave them funding from his confidential funds, from his intelligence funds. Which, and he does that for every other agency na kulang yung pondo. For example, nagkaroon ng baha, nagkaroon ng kalamidad, earthquake, bagyo. The president also steps in with his intelligence funds or confidential funds to give to the LGUs, to give to the communities for assistance. And so, basically, very important yan. On the other agencies,
the civilian,
they have to justify.
But you have civilian agencies. Sabi nga ni Senator J.B. Herset, o medyo ngayon nawiwile kasi ang DepEd meron, may iba na rin na humihingi ng intelligence fund when they're a civilian agency.
Well, we will see, as I said again, no, we have an oversight function. We have a subcommittee or special committee in charge of that for oversight funds. We will activate the special committee during this budget season, which is the next 2 months, and then we will ask the agencies that will have intelligence funds. We will invite them to the executive session with the special committee. We will ask what they did with the budget and how they spent it, and then we will come up with a educated decision when the time comes to push for the budget in plenary.
Okay, now you have 20 priority measures by year end. This is a commitment you made to the LEDAC, right? So all I've read the 20 that you've committed to. I wanted to ask you, the mandatory ROTC, where do you stand on that? Is that conditional? Is that secondary? Or do you have the numbers in the Senate that you really want to pass mandatory ROTC?
Karen, I'm a product of ROTC. I was in the UP, and you know the UP, and I think you also had to go through CAT when we were in high school in San Agustin.
Yeah. Yeah.
I went through it like every other dutiful teenager or college student at that time. I learned a lot from it. You know, being a sabi nga nila, tisoy na anak mayaman, dumaan din ako sa putik, dumaan din ako sa marcha, and it grounded me. And I think I learned a lot from that experience. It made me a better person. So if you ask me personally, my personal vote is yes, I will vote in favor of ROTC. Uh-huh. It is, remember that I'm the principal author of the NSTP as well.
Yeah.
Karen, maraming loopholes sa NSTP. Ha? Ang dami kong kilala na hindi sila nagserbisyo sa NSTP. Nagpalakas lang po sila sa isang org at doon nila minasahe yung mga leader ng org na yan para bigyan sila ng passing grade sa NSTP. So maraming nakakalusot, they learn nothing. Unfortunately, that was the norm. No?
Yeah. Pero so, ROTC, you're most likely gonna vote for it. It has your vote. Okay.
That's now, my vote.
Yes.
We made it a conscience vote, Karen. We're consensus. I'm a consensus builder, so we listen to consensus. So it's going to be a conscience vote because I know some members of mine feel strongly against it.
Yeah.
So I said, if that's the way you feel, then let's make this a conscience vote. So it's a conscience vote. Ang akin lang dyan, Karen, is how to improve the ROTC, not to only keep it just into marching and
shifting
once a year and all that. Yeah. We're gonna try to improve it. Senator Pia Cayetano is very good. She is very good at plans and amendments and proposals. For example, if you're a computer genius, Karen, you don't have to march in the field. You don't have to march in the field, carry a garand and do all this exhibition and all. You can stay in an office in the school and you can be part of the cyber warfare class.
Okay.
And you can be in an air-conditioned room and that's your expertise. So it's not necessarily the old, stereotype na when you say ROTC, marcha, hala, marcha dyan, in and out of the field. So it will be modified, in other words, to suit modern-day training.
Okay. What about the issue for the pension on military uniformed personnel? Do you believe that this will pass? It's quite, you have the business sector is quite interested in this for some reason, no? So palagay nyo ito before the end of the year, ipapasa nyo na to.
Alam mo, Karen, kailangan natin maipasa ito dahil hindi na po sustainable ang pension system ng ating armed forces. And you can ask this, maybe if you invite Sunny to come to your show, you can ask it, he'll show you that the next year or two, or I think, I believe by next year, lampas na ang binabayaran natin sa pension kaysa active military personnel. And that's you and me, Karen. We're paying for it under our taxpayers' money. Unlike you or I, you're in the SSS, I'm in the GSIS, there's a pension fund which is managed properly na doon gagaling yung kanilang pension. Hindi po galing sa gobyerno, hindi po galing sa taxpayers' fund. So we really have to come up with a system that's sustainable. Pero I want to put this on record. Dapat as painless as possible para sa ating armed forces and kapulisan. Bakit kaya? Nagbubuwis buhay po sila para sa atin. It's not fair na yung kaltas natin sa GSIS and SSS ay pareho ng sundalo at sa kapulisan. So Ang akin dyan, we'll make it as painless as possible for them, but there should be some sort of contribution nevertheless.
Okay, now other issues, just very quickly, because I'm going to move on to agriculture to close. You are also supporting the creation of the Negros Island region. And I just want to be quick on this. For our viewers, this would mean the Negros Island region, which is Negros Occidental, Oriental, and Siquijor. Why is there relevant, considering that the Department of Budget and Management doesn't want new regions or departments as much as possible? What makes the difference? Let's say you put this region, you make it into a law, pero wala namang pondo, Senate President. Bakit po
actually, Actually, Karen, matagal ng NIR, that was the time of Pinoy. There was already the Negros Island region implemented by then Secretary Mar of the DILG. And it made things efficient. Ako taga Negros kasi ako, you know, Karen, yung tatay ko is from Kabangkalan, Negros Occidental. And kailangan nila pumunta ng Iloilo to get their permits, certificates from the regional offices. And the same goes also for Negros Oriental. They would have to go to Cebu. You know how far Cebu is from Negros Oriental, Cebu City?
Yeah.
Very
yeah.
far. So we wanted to make things more efficient, no? And just go back to all the efficiency of having one Negros Island region. The population there is even more than other regions. It's a bigger population than other regions that are already existing today. For example, Region 4B. Mas malaki itong Negros Island region times 2 sa Region 4B. Ang punto ko lang dyan, Karen, is efficiency. Now, okay. When it comes to the VBM stand on no departments, no regions, that's on a case-to-case basis. Why? The president's pushing for the Department of Water.
Yeah, that's true.
It's contradictory what the president says.
That's a good point. Are you also going to push for water?
Yes. Yes, I'm a principal author of the Department of Water. So it's under Senator Grace Poe's, I believe, Committee on the Public Services, and she's working on it. And hopefully in the next couple of weeks, she'll be sponsoring already in the plenary the committee report. So these are things that are low-lying fruits that we feel is achievable. They're happy bills. We're trying to pass as many as we can before the year end.
Okay. Now, as Senate President, I mean, after Typhoon Ega, you did speak with President Marcos Jr. and you are pushing for what you describe as rice production zones.
Yes.
Actually, when I read the research, I mean, the article, it's quite interesting because don't we already have rice production zones, considering we are rice, we produce rice? What do you mean exactly by this? The rice production zone, and under the budget for 2024, how does this change the national rice program?
When we met over dinner with the president 2 weeks ago in Malacañang, in his residence, sabi ko nga kay presidente, Sir President, I know you're having a hard time with rice now. India's closing shop, Vietnam is closing shop.
Yeah.
But the beauty of rice,
closing shop, you can't buy.
You can't buy. They're closing their borders. Yeah, they're closing their borders for whatever reason. No? India, I think they're having an El Nino, so the people are panicking. So the government decided to make a political decision. No export of non-basmati rice. Yes, no export of non-basmati rice, which is what we buy. Alam mo, Karen, nung nag-usap ko kami ni Presidente, you know, my background is agriculture, education, and profession. So that's my specialty. I suggest to the president, let's forget the shotgun approach, Mr. President. The shotgun approach is, boom, you have a program. It's mothered statements. You're hoping that the regional directors will follow through on this. The beauty of rice, Karen, is this. It's only 90 days. If you don't have rice now, if you plant, magsipag ka, you'll have rice in 90 days.
Okay,
it's easy.
Point.
It's not like sugar,
okay,
which
point.
Is 1 year, or pineapple, which is 2 years. 90 days to get. So I asked the president, Mr. President, let's focus. Get your USEX and ASEX, which you have so much of. Because we devolved the DA. The DA is devolved now.
Yeah.
So you're top heavy. The DA is top heavy. So let these USEX and ASEX and the regional directors pick rice producing zones in their areas. For example, if I were the president, I'll get USEC Panganiban to take charge of Central Luzon.
Okay.
What are the rice producing areas? Nueva Ecija, Pampanga, Bulacan. Tutukan ni USEC Panganiban yan.
Dapat yun lang.
Yun lang.
Huwag
niyo naisipin ng iba. Yun lang. That's the point.
That's good.
And it's targeted. Targeted.
Yes.
So
yes.
He has to memorize all their names. If there are 10,000 farmers there, they have to be 10,000 best friends. And then he'll give fertilizer, seeds. He'll give the mechanized equipment, the technology training, and skills training to be able to plant the rice. Tutukan niya yan. Hindi niya iiwan yan. Yeah. He makes a report, Mr. President. This is the production now. And in 90 days, I promise you, we'll have a 40% increase. And he has to follow through with that. If the president does that throughout the country, believe you me, I'm sure our production will increase.
But Senate President, why hasn't this ever been done if it's this simple? I mean, during Pinoy's time, I remember, if you remember correctly, the highest growth of the agriculture was 2%. And then when Pinoy closed, am I right? It was at zero or even negative growth. Parang it was such a challenge. Tama. But
challenge talaga siya, Karen, you know why? Kasi devolved yung agriculture. Nung panahon ng tatay ni BBM, there was the Masagana 99. The whole Department of Agriculture, you had technicians that went, I remember that clearly, technicians in overalls na kalagay Department of Agriculture, Masagana 99, they would be carrying booklets and they would be going into the barangays, not where they're planting. Wala na yan na yun. When we passed the local government code, Karen, we downloaded it to the province and to the municipalities. It is unfortunate that there are certain provinces, the priority is not agriculture. So they get the glorified landscaper to be the provincial agriculture officer. You know, pampagandaan lang ng plaza ang ginagawa nila. Unfortunately, that's what happened. So the president has to tap its top-heavy personnel. There's still thousands of people working under the DA. And he should target it now, Karen. Yes. Kasi dati, you go to your, you apply. If you're a farmer, you apply for the program, punta ka sa regional office. Doon mo lang makukuha yung makikita yung mga bini, yung mga fertilizer. So now, yung regional director, for example, tututukan yan, yung mga areas na yan. Uh-huh. You give a report to the president every 90 days, every quarter.
Correct. And you want to see an increase. This is a good point. If it's only 90 days, in 3 months, this is easy
Correct.
To measure.
Yes. So all the land that you see that's not being planted now, in 90 days, you can have rice.
Yeah.
You can have food. So, dyan, kailangan ng tutukan. There has to be an accountability measure because the president can't make the governors and mayors, unfortunately, accountable. He's frustrated, and I'm frustrated with the local governments.
So, to close, I mean, just quickly, because I have a commercial break still. We've had you, but like for a whole 45 minutes now, do you think it's time for President Marcos Jr. to already appoint an agriculture secretary? I mean, it's already one
you
year.
You know, Karen, with my dealings with the president this past year, his priority is agriculture. He's learned a lot. I don't think at this point in time to slow down, I don't think he wants to slow down the momentum.
So you
kasi
don't think he's
sila sa kanya.
Anyone soon?
I don't think so. And I think he's doing a yeoman's job and trying to keep the Department of Agriculture together in spite of the floods, in spite of the typhoons. But he has to follow through with these projects. And my dear President, if you're listening, RPZs, rice producing zones, rice production zones, let's focus, not shotgun, but targeting. And I promise you, Mr. President, that will work. And hopefully we'll be able to increase our production at least 30 to 40% for the next cropping season.
All right. My last question for you is, this is the last, is you already have the Regional Wage Board approving 40 pesos, right? A day for private workers. But you originally wanted 150 pesos. And recently, you are open to modifying your proposal down to 100 pesos. So that would mean if you were going to legislate an increase, it's an additional 60. Tama? 60
hindi
na lang.
Karen, no? First of all, hindi pa ako titigil dyan. Ha? We're going to push for that. People need decent and living wages.
So
and the 40 pesos is only for NCR, Karen. Ha? The people in Bukidnon, the people in Cebu, the people in Samar, the people in Northern Luzon have not gotten an increase. So they're only 340 pesos, 380 pesos a day.
Uh-oh.
And the gastos is the same. Electricity is the same. Food is the same. The McDonald's and Jollibee are the same. So, you know, it's the same. So basically, we want an across-the-board increase pa rin. But we might modify NCR to make it to 100 para umabot sa 150 pa rin, close to the 150 figure.
I see.
Everywhere else will be across the board as well.
Okay, and quickly, do you think this will be passed by the end of the year or hindi to included in the 20 priority bills muna?
I do not know the feeling and sentiments of the House of Representatives, but in the Senate, we'll make a stand on this. Senator Jinggo Estrada, the chairman of the Committee on Labor, committed to me that we'll bring out the committee report very soon. Hopefully, right. Be a Christmas gift to the Filipino people. So 40 pesos is welcome, but it's not enough. We welcome it, but it's not enough.
On that note, I want to thank you for starting out the week with us on Head Start. This has been quite extensive and informative. Thank you for your insights. Juan Miguel Zubiri, thank you.
Hey, Karen, thank you very much also for the opportunity. And remember, sa national anthem natin, sa manlulubig, hindi ka pasisil. Sa at na mga kababayan, mahalin natin ang ating bansang Pilipinas. Thank you, Karen.